Okay, so let's start with the very basic concepts, okay? I assume that all of you have an Emacs process running in your computer.
Sorry, mine is running on thumbscrolls. Is that okay?
No, it is not. So, the first thing that we want you to perform is to open a terminal in your desktop and to launch the Emacs command. But don't touch anything in the process. Well, you can if you want. So I will do it also. Emacs. But you should launch the command using an additional parameter that is dash q minus q. It should be quick. Okay? You have it? Good. This is a very basic Emacs installation. It's like if you get an animal from the country. This Emacs doesn't have a proper education, for example. It is wild. And, well, it may depend of the specific distribution that you are using, because some of the distributions, like Debian, they like to introduce some more or less hidden configuration files in the system for Emacs. But more or less, this is the appearance of a wild Emacs. You should see in your computer something very similar to this. So what do you see in your screen? You see that Emacs is an educated program, so the first thing it does when you start it is to greet you. It says welcome to GNU Emacs, that is one component of the GNU Linux operating system. Okay? And then you have in the screen some more or less useful information, including some links to some sections of the integrated health system that you have in Emacs. Good. Of course, the utility of this welcome message is relative. You may find it useful when you are starting using the program, but after that you get used to see it, but you never use it, basically. Also, you should know that you are using Emacs 23 or CVS Emacs. For this version of Emacs, the Emacs developer decided to expand the information of this greeting message. If you press any key in your, the Q key. Previously it was any key. Now you should press the Q key. The greeting message disappears, and then you find something like this. To put it short, this is the scratch buffer. Now we will explain what a buffer is, but basically it is like. The default buffer that you get when you start Emacs without specifying a specific file. Okay? So what do we have in the screen? Here is what we call a window in the Emacs terminology. Okay? Through the window we are looking at some content that is the content of some buffer. And this line in the bottom of the screen is what we call the mode line. This one. In the mode line we have several very interesting information about the buffer that we are looking at using the window. I warn you in advance, Emacs is old. It's quite old. And for example, Emacs predates the modern graphical environments, including the one in the Macintosh, for example. So you will find that we will be using some wording like window. You are familiar, I suppose, with the modern desktop environment where what is a window? In GNOME, for example, or in KDE. It's a window that you can move, you can resize, and you can overlap. right? In the Emacs terminology that predates the terminology used in the desktop environment, a window is this one. What you might call a window in a desktop environment, in the Emacs terminology we call it a frame. Okay? Good. There is a difference between a buffer and a window. There are a lot of differences. There are different concepts. Basically, well, of course, here in your Scratch buffer, now you can edit it. You can insert content and modify the existing contents. But you can think there is a very successful metaphor that is usually applied here, in that you can consider the Emacs windows as holes. Okay? As holes through which you are looking into a buffer. What does that mean? That means that there may be buffers without a current window in the screen showing it. In the opposite, every window should have some kind of buffer behind. So, for example, I can create a new window in the screen. So basically we have now a frame that is the whole screen currently, and two windows. But both windows, both holes, are showing us the same buffer. So of course if I insert contents in the upper window, using the upper window, it also shows in the bottom window. Also you might see that now there are two different mode lines. One mode line per window. Okay? Good. It is incorrect to say that the mode line contains information just for the buffer, because that is not true. It contains information about the buffer, but also information about the window. And in any case, each mode line is associated with a window, not with a buffer. Okay? What information do we have in the mode line? Okay. Now we can see some strange characters here in the left part of the mode line that we will explain what they are for, but not now. And here, this is the buffer name. That is the name of the buffer that you are showing using that window. In this case, it's asterisk scratch asterisk. A hint, in Emacs, sometimes you get buffers that you didn't create explicitly. For example, the scratch buffer. In that situation, there is a convention that is never forced, but it's just a convention, in that automatically created buffers always starts and ends with stars. Okay? And usually, the buffers that you create, you never start and ends the name of your buffer with asterisks. Then, you can see here that this is the size indication mode. That basically it is telling you what percentage, where are you in the current location of the window into the buffer. In this case, since this buffer is really small, it tells you all. In the sense that you are showing the whole contents of the buffer in that window. But if we add more contents, let me move to the upper one. Now it reads bot, because you are showing in the window in the bottom part of the buffer. But look. Oh. Now it's indicating to you that you are showing more or less the 92%, that the 92% of the buffer is above the portion of the buffer that you are showing in the window. Okay? It's as simple as that. Also, you have a line indicator that it tells you in what line you have the pointer. And then you have the mode indicators. The description is wrong, because it says to you that this tip is telling us that it is the major mode. And that is not exact, because in this area of the mode line you have a description of what is the major mode on the buffer that you are showing in the window, but also the several minor modes, if any, that you have activated in your buffer. We will explain with calm what a mode is. And then for now we don't have more information in the mode line. Okay? Good. So, of course, you can create more windows in your screen, in your Emacs frame. You can try it right now. You can split the frame in an horizontal way. Okay? Like this one. That you are creating a new window that by default is pointing, is showing the same buffer in the same position. Okay? But also you can create, well, you can do it with Ctrl X 2 by default. Try it. With Ctrl X 2. It works. Also with, you can also split the window, the frame, to create a new window in a vertical way. That is in this way. That is with Ctrl X 3 instead of 2. This is really interesting because after several years using Emacs, you come to associate 3 with verticality and 2 with horizontality. It's really strange, but after some time it makes sense. Okay, you can repeat the operation anytime you want. For example, now we will be interested, for example, in a split, in creating a new window below the current window. So we will repeat, we will make a Ctrl X 2. Of course, you can repeat the operation, for example, this way. And again, well, and not again, because there is a limit that you can configure, by the way. You see? So now we have a lot of different windows in the same Emacs frame, but all these windows are showing exactly the same buffer. Okay, to move from one window to the another, there is a very handy keystroke that is Ctrl X O. In this case, O is for other. Move to other window, to another window. You can practice. Okay, now, but now we have a mess in the frame because we have a lot of windows in the frame, and we may want to pick one of the window. And there is a way to tell Emacs to destroy all the other any other window, so that the window that we are currently in will make use of all the space available in the frame. And the keystroke for that is Ctrl X 1. Boom. It makes sense. Two, with Ctrl X 2 you split in a horizontal way. With Ctrl X 3 you split in a vertical way, because everyone is associating the number 3 with verticality. With Ctrl X O you can move change the focus to the next window. And with Ctrl X 1 you make the current window, the currently activated window, to make use of all this available space in the frame. What happened with the rest of the windows? They were destroyed. But you don't care about it. because the buffer that you were operating using those windows is exactly the same. You didn't destroy it. Okay? Good. There is another one, another keystroke that is, okay, and what happens if I want to destroy a window? So, for example, now we have three different windows in this frame, right? And I want to destroy specifically the window that is in the bottom right side of the frame. For that, you have yet another keystroke that is Control X 0. It also makes sense. Everyone associates the 0 with destruction, and especially Luca, for example. That is, he's bloody wrong. The current window, boom. Okay, a lot of ignorant people, especially the ignorant people that also have a totally lack of any common sense, that is the people that use VI in a continuous way, they are always complaining about it. Emacs has a lot of key strokes, okay? A lot of key bindings. Now we learned 5 of them. Do you find it difficult to remember? Well, of course, you need a bit of practice. But after you spend 10 minutes using this kind of keystrokes, you get it. Okay. Good. This is for Windows. In Emacs, you also have frames. Like this one. Well, you know that here I'm using a really unusual desktop environment, so I don't have overlapping frames. Okay. But the concept is exactly the same. Any question? No. It's really easy, right? Good. Let's go with the frames. For the frames. In the Emacs terminology, a frame is exactly what you call a window in a modern graphical environment. Okay? So, for example, you can create a new frame in a very similar way that you created a new window into this frame. How do you create the frame, a new frame? And you can guess? Control X 5-2. This is a new frame. Okay, now there is also a keystroke to switch to another frame. Can you guess? No, don't read the referent. Don't read the referent. I mean the design of these keystrokes that was made by Guy Steele. You know that. Yeah, so show respect and don't cheat. Okay. So given the information that you have in the screen, can you guess what would be the keystroke to switch to another frame? Control X? Good. So you see it's really difficult. Control X 5-0. Okay, of course, you can also destroy a frame. What is the keystroke to destroy a frame? Right. Control X 5-0. By default, it is in that way. Try it. Control X 5-2. You are creating a new frame that is using a new window that is showing exactly the same buffer, that is the scratch buffer, right? And you can destroy the frame with Control X 5-0. So it's really complicated. In this case, the design of the keystrokes, for example, in this case, is using this 5 as a sort of prefix. I don't know why the number 5 was chosen for this specific design. Do you know that, Alfred? No? But nevertheless, you can guess what the keystroke may be, based in some previous knowledge, like the keystrokes for the Windows. So now, after 10 minutes, of course, we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 8 different keystrokes. And you can remember them all, right? Good. So, this is for the windows and the frames. But there are more things in the screen. For example, here we have a really disgusting thing that is the toolbar. With some icons. I don't have a clue, I don't know for what these buttons are, because I never used them. Never. Specify, well, this is for to create a new file's name to edit the file. Hey, this is I will say that if you see an icon with a blank paper, you will understand if you're in Emacs that it is for creating a new buffer, but it seems that no. Specify a new file's name to edit the file. Well, I am discovering today that the descriptions of the tooltips in Emacs sucks, really sucks, but I was not aware of this. Yeah, find the file, but the icon is wrong. It's a blank paper. Well, forget. You know why? This is one of the reasons I recommend of the people to do this. You don't need to understand the semantics, but it's not difficult.
The icon creates a new file, doesn't it? It actually does create a new file. It doesn't create the buffer, creates a file and then associates the file.
Yeah. So the icon is wrong.
Well, no, it isn't. It creates a real file on disk.
Yeah. No, not the description, the icon. I will never associate a blank paper with the action of creating a file and setting a buffer with it. But anyway, write a line like this one, open parentheses, toolbar mode, -1, you close the parentheses, put the cursor under the close parentheses, and type Ctrl X, Ctrl E. Like this. Okay? Much better. Now, we want two additional lines, more space for two additional lines, and we won't get distracted by that sheet, that is the toolbar. Good. Also, please write down this line also. And Ctrl X, Ctrl E. Here. You will see that the second Lisp expression, the effect is to remove the menu bar. So we want even more space for an additional line, and I'm sure that you are already experts in using menus, so it's not of interest in this course. Okay? Good. Well, I'll keep it here. Okay, now let's go for the buffer. In this case, this scratch buffer and any other Emacs buffer is a buffer that is in memory, of course, like in most of the text editors. Then the algorithms implementing that the innards of these buffers in text editors is really funny, but it is not the topic. So this is a buffer in memory. In an Emacs buffer, you can have a lot of stuff. You can have text, that is the primary use of an Emacs buffer, but you can also have images, for example, or even sounds, or links, or buttons, or radio box, radio buttons, and that kind of stuff. But primarily, you have text in Emacs buffers. So, of course, you can modify the text. What happens when you finish modifying the contents of a buffer? That the buffer is in memory, and in this case, this buffer is not associated with any file in your hard disk. This scratch buffer is like, I will say in Spanish, is like para tomar notas. In fact, you have it in the comment in the beginning of the buffer, that this buffer is for notes you don't want to save, and for Lisp evaluation. In fact, that is what we are using it for. To make notes, that is the key strokes that you are learning that you don't want to save, because I already know them, and for Lisp evaluation, because we evaluated two Lisp forms. So this is a buffer. You can create new buffers, of course. How do you create a new buffer? With this keystroke, this Control X B. If you press Control X B from buffer, then we get a little message in a little area that is in the bottom of the screen. This is the mini buffer. Also, it is a funny name, but also it's really exact, because the implementation of the mini buffer is like, it is a buffer also, but with some special properties. Okay, Emacs use the mini buffer to communicate with you, basically. So when Emacs want to get some kind of information, like in this specific case, it uses the mini buffer to prompt you for that information. In this case, we launched the Control X V command. That is the command that switches to buffer. And Emacs, that is quite polite, by the way, it asks you, switch to buffer, to what buffer? And then you should specify the name of a buffer. Note that you also get a suggestion from Emacs. In this case, Emacs is guessing, is suggesting to you, well, it's guessing that you may be interested in to switch to a buffer named asterisk messages asterisk. What can you tell me about that buffer? It starts with an asterisk and ends with an asterisk, so it's a buffer that, of course, we didn't create. So it was automatically created by Emacs for some purpose, but we are not interested in that buffer for the moment. So now we want to create a buffer. So we do that by simple specify a name for a buffer. So my buffer, for example. In this case, Emacs will create a new empty buffer for us with that name. Okay? Good. Take a look to the mode line. Of course, you will find the expected values here. The strange character at the left of the mode line, that forget about them for the moment. Then the name of the buffer that we just created, in this case is my buffer. Of course, the buffer is empty, so of course this window is showing all the contents of the buffer. The cursor is in the first line of the buffer because it is empty, so as expected. And in this area that where we get this strange thing that is a major mode, we can read fundamental. This means, grossly speaking, this means more or less that Emacs doesn't have a clue about what kind of contents of the buffer it can expect to find in the buffer. So it's neutral, fundamental, text, any kind of text. Okay? Good, of course you can start filling the buffer with some contents. for example. Okay. Good, we are still manipulating a memory buffer, of course. So that means that if we close Emacs at this point, I won't do it, and please don't do that, but if we close Emacs at this point, we will lose the contents of this buffer. Okay, good. Oh, before that, now we are editing this buffer. We have just one frame, and we have just one window, right? And we are using this window to visualize to the hole. We created a big hole pointing to this buffer. But for example, but the scratch buffer is still there. In fact, you can switch. We can switch again. We can switch back to the scratch buffer with Ctrl X V, remember? And look that Emacs, that is really, really, really polite, Emacs knows that the last buffer that we were working on was the scratch buffer. So Emacs is suggesting us, is guessing that we may be interested in switching to that buffer, and we are, so we simple press enter, that is to get the default value, the suggestion from Emacs. Okay. What does it mean? This means that you have a list of buffers into the editor, and that they are persistent, of course, in memory. Okay, so we can go back again with Ctrl XP to my buffer. Okay, of course, now we could create a new window and then create a new buffer in the new window. Try it. Create a new window in the same frame, either in any part of the frame, and then create a new buffer called, for example, my buffer 2 or something like that. Got it? Yes? Okay, so we could also to create a new window in the same frame to switch to the window and to visualize the scratch buffer, for example. Or also, we could create a new frame and visualize a specific buffer. Well, you get it. Good. But of course, you may forget about the buffers that you have in your system, in your Emacs. Because after working with Emacs for several hours, you can accumulate, or even for several days, or even for several weeks or months, you can accumulate a really big number, a lot of different buffers, and you may forget about them. So, if you try to switch to a new buffer, or to an existing one, and you get a prompt in the mini buffer. Most of the time, Emacs asks something to us using the mini buffer, prompts for some value. Most of the time, we can request some autocompletion information. That is with the tab key. press it just once. And now we have here in the screen, we have a really, really interesting screen. What happened? Emacs created a new buffer called completions that is exactly like my buffer, but this buffer was created with Emacs with some content, and the content is the different possibility that you have for autocompletion. But also Emacs created a new window to show you that information. You see it? Good, so for example, here we can autocomplete to Scratch, for example, or to my buffer 2. But before doing that, there are more interesting facts in this really simple screen. For example, could you tell me how much buffers we have in this Emacs session? 3? No. Okay, we have my buffer. My buffer 2. The scratch buffer and the messages buffer, but also a completions buffer. But Emacs is smart enough to not include in the autocompletion information a buffer that you already have in the window where you were when you requested to switch to a different buffer, because it would be really stupid, okay, to do that. But also, it is intelligent enough to not include the newly created completions buffer. You know what I mean? Because it will be also really stupid. Huh?
I have it.
You have what? You have the completions buffer in the name in the contents of the completions.
Okay.
What version of Emacs are you using?
You write asterisk and then you tab.
And of course, but I did not say to write down an asterisk. Okay, repeat the process. Rollback. Control G. Control G is a really important keystroke in Emacs because it's abort. Control G. Control G. Okay? Okay, repeat it. Control X, B. And then press the tab once. Hey, now it's there. because it was already created. Yeah, that is the difference. But anyway, my buffer is not in that list. But this screen is interesting, for example, to see that Emacs itself is using a really few number of concepts to, for example, to build a list of completions. Brain dead text editors or even word processor, maybe they would have used a special mechanism to tell you the names of the available buffers, like, I don't know, a context menu or something like that. In Emacs use a buffer to do it and a window to do it, and this is beautiful. It is simple and it is easy to understand, right? Good. Of course, you can switch to the completions buffer, for example, and you have the latest content that was calculated for autocompletion. Well, it is not possible to modify the contents of this buffer by default, because by default it is created as a read-only buffer. Of course, you can change it. Because that is yet another great thing about Emacs. You can do almost everything without any arbitrary restrictions. Okay. Switch to the my buffer 2. Imagine that we are finished working with this buffer and we want to destroy the buffer. Okay? Good. There is a keystroke for this. That is Control X, Okay. Emacs asks for you for the name of the buffer that you want to destroy, to kill, in the Emacs terminology. By default, it is the same buffer as you are iterating when you launch the command. Okay, in this case, my buffer 2. Beware in that if you destroy a buffer that is in memory, like this one, it is just only memory, like this one, we will lose the contents of the buffer. Okay? So, we can abort the killing with Control G. Remember, Control G to abort. And then we want to save this content into a file. Before to be able to save the contents of this buffer into a file, we need to associate this buffer with a file in our file system, okay? And we can do it with Control X, Control S. S for save, so Control X, Control S. And then Emacs asks for a name of a file to save this content. We can use, for example, tmp myfile2, for example. So we save the contents of the buffer. What happened here? There are some details here that is worth to comment. We get a message in the mini buffer where Emacs is telling us that he wrote the contents of the mybuffer2 buffer into, in this case, home hemarch tmp myfile2. But what happened with the name of the buffer? It was mybuffer2, but now it changed. Now it is no longer mybuffer2. Now it is my file 2. That is exactly the same that the name of the file, the base name of the file that we use to save the content. And that is because this buffer now has an associated file. And an Emacs buffer that is associated with a file always has the same name that the base name of the file. That is a good idea because it helps to identify to which file you have this buffer associated. The next time, if you make some modifications to the buffer and you want to save the contents of this buffer into the same as in the associated file, you simply repeat the Control X, Control S. But this time, Emacs won't ask you for the name of the file because it's already there. Okay? Okay, you might think that most of the time, you will be using buffers associated with files, but it depends. Most of the time, you may do some work in one buffer associated with one file, and then with more than 20 buffers that are just in memory. So the distinction is important. Of course, if we quit the program at that point, we can open the file later. How do you open a file in Emacs? With Control X, Control F. That is calling the find file command. You can open, etc pass, for example. Good. When you run the command find file, Emacs reads the contents of the file from the disk. It creates a new buffer. Name it after the file, in this case, passwd. Then Emacs reads the contents of the file and dumps the contents into the buffer. And then Emacs associates the buffer with that file. But for example, Emacs is not creating a new window for you. It's reusing the same window that we are using for myfile2, for example. And you can notice that Emacs was smart enough to detect that I am editing the etc password file, and then now this means that Emacs knows something about the how to edit this kind of files, also for the colors. Okay, so play with it for 5 minutes, just to get used. Open some files, write down some files. Do you know that now we came with one of the first important differences between a real editor and some pseudo editors? That some pseudo editors, for example, you have not the possibility to work with a buffer, without having an associated file with it. And that is a really stupid limitation. In Emacs you can. Yeah, now it's the number 2. Triple moose 6 is undefined. Huh? Buttons.
6 is the index of the buttons.
Yeah, that's incredible. I have 2 buttons.
But you have the
In the side of the that should be. Are you going outside? I'm going with you.
Thank you. They took a break or?
Yes,
okay.
For a cigarette.
Ah, okay. Smoke is no good. No good for health and no good for your pocket, no good for money. I've got a friend of mine from London and he smokes a lot. He comes with pain and with tobacco here because in London it's very, very expensive. And one day we were looking how many money do they spend in 1 year tobacco, and he can buy one car, maybe one BMW or something like that. And this year, this Easter, I went to Dublin, and when back it,
my news,
something like that.
Something very, very expensive.
Not only maybe. I got it.
Do you know this flow of the GNU/lib? Well, I can do it. In the Exalog module, that is with error checking, with out of memory checking, you cannot just return from Exalog die. So, and it is a problem for us because in the GNU PDF library we are using some GNU/lib modules that are in turn using the Exalog module, and that means that the library will die. If an out of memory situation is detected, and it should not do that, of course, because a library should never die in that situation. You can try to get to free some memory. You can report it to that situation to the user if possible. No, not with print. No, I mean, but you should. Imagine the user is using some call to the GNU PDF library, PDF something. And there is an out-of-memory condition. You will expect from a library to communicate to you, if possible, with its allocated memory, just by returning some error code, that there is an out-of-memory condition. The problem... Okay, so if you try that to create an Exalog die function that is an operation, basically, for example, the array list module crashes. Because the GNU/lib modules are not prepared to for that eventuality.
I don't think that's a problem.
No, it is. I don't want the GNU PDF library to kill the application in that condition.
Well,
in that situation.
If you are out of memory, then you're shit out of luck anyway. So.
No, because you could the user may be interested in manage that error condition by freeing some memory. In my opinion, a library should never stop the application in an error condition. Well, of course, if you have a division by zero, maybe, but
not even that.
No, well,
with the division by zero, I agree, but when you have no memory to use.
And the problem is that you have an indirect dependency if you use the GNU/lib modules.
Yeah.
Okay, of course.
That's what I agree with, but crashing hard when you're out of memory is the only correct thing to do, even if it's in the memory.
I disagree. If possible, you should communicate the error condition to the user.
The thing is that a lot of things that you depend on can use malloc or something like that.
Ah, good, but if possible. Huh?
It is better if you are able to do it.
Yeah.
Even at GNU standards say it is permissible to abort the problem.
By a library?
No, by malloc framework.
Yes, but malloc used directly in an application, not in a library. In fact, I think that there is something in the GNU coding standards talking about this, I think. Let's see. Yeah.
And then try to do your normal work.
Yeah.
And every application, you'll use it for about 2 minutes. Like Firefox, you can use it for 2 minutes. And then it will just disappear.
Yeah.
And you get no error message, it just crashes, and you've got no idea why.
Hmm. So you agree with me that this is a bug in GNU/lib?
Absolutely.
Yeah. We should talk with Bruno. Yeah, Alex? And to prepare a patch, but the problem is that the first step will be to identify all the modules using depending on the Exalog module, and then apply a lot of patches. because, for example, the list modules are not working. If Exalog dies, is not actually dying. Also, you have this macro attribute not return. Luca, do you have a copy of the standards?
Yeah.
Take a look, because I think that it yeah.
Try to make library functions returns. If they need to do dynamic storage allocation, at least try to avoid adding non-redundancy aside from that itself.
Yeah.
Basically,
no.
No, it does not say anything about malloc and libraries. What it says, in non-interactive programs, if malloc fails in a non-interactive program, make that a fatal error. In an interactive program, open parentheses, one that reads commands from the user, close parentheses, it is better to abort the command and return to the command with the group.
Okay, you cannot do that using GNU/lib.
No, okay.
Yeah, so it's a bug.
Yeah. Well, you could use instead of xmalloc die something with long jumps for the command.
Whoa.
It's very dangerous and hard to use.
Yeah. So look, for example, in the array list. Where is it? In this one, and also any call to Exalog, any explicit call to Exalog. But okay. So, let's continue with Emacs. Ah, it's true.
The two.
Okay, so now let's move to more interesting stuff. Go to my buffer or any other buffer. And write some contents there. A little paragraph. So, in an Emacs buffer, usually you have text, like in this case. Okay, and the text has a structure in lines and columns. In Emacs, you start counting lines from one, so it is a natural number in the classical meaning of the term. Okay, as natural number from one to some unknown limit. So you can see it in the mode line, that now the cursor is in the first line. 1, 2, 3, and so on. The column is also similar. The first column is the number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and so on.
The first column is number 0.
The column, that's true.
Number.
Yeah, it is a non-negative integer number, in the classical meaning of the term, okay? Yeah, wow. Okay. Also, there is an important property of a window. That is associated with a window, but just to be short, we usually say that it's associated with the buffer and not with the window. Okay? that is the pointer. The pointer and the cursor. That are the separated concepts. The cursor is a cursor. No, that comes from the Latin word cursor. Yeah, it's a little... It is not a translation to English. It was adoption of the literal word, cursor. The cursor is, in this case, this black box. And you may think that it is a really simple concept, right? Because you are used to find cursors in a lot of different applications. But it is not that simple. Because the cursor in Emacs is a visual representation of a different concept, that is the pointer. Okay? The pointer is an integer, a non-negative integer, from 0 to whatever. So, the cursor is telling you what is the current value in a visual way of the pointer for this specific window or this specific buffer. Okay? Now, the value of the pointer that we can get in this way, you are not required to understand this for the moment, but... what was the function to get the value of the pointer? I cannot believe that... Point, okay. Okay, right now the value is 1. If we move the cursor one position to the right, then the value is 2. And so on. Okay? So the minimum value of the point is 1, 2, the maximum value. So, the pointer value is not telling you a position of a character in the buffer, but it is telling you the position between characters. Do you understand what I mean? It's different. So, the position corresponding to a value of the point 1 is the position before the first character in the buffer. Okay? The associativity of the point is to the left. We can say that in that way. If we move the cursor, that is the same to say, if we move the cursor one position to the right, now the cursor is in top of the U, the value of the point of the pointer is 2. That corresponds to the position that is between the big Q and the U in this case. Okay? And so on. If we move the cursor to this position, that is the last position in the current line, the value of the pointer is, I don't know, some number, depending on the length of the line, in this case 26. But now, the value of the pointer is giving you the position between the O and the new line character. Okay? If we move the cursor one position to the right, now what is giving the point? The point is meaning what? The position between what characters? Right. So now in this position, the pointer is between the O from Mayo and the new line character. But here, the pointer is between the new line character and the C. And we will see shortly, in 10 minutes, that it is really important when you define a region. Because in this case, you will be including the new line into the region, but not in this situation. Okay? And so on. But it is important that the pointer is telling you a position between characters in the buffer. Not in top of any given character. Okay? Good. You can imagine, you can consider the pointer like an integer variable associated with the window. And why I am talking about windows, but despite most of the people is talking about the pointer of a buffer, because the latter is wrong. Why? Split create a new window that points to the same buffer. Now the cursor is in this position. That means that the value of the pointer in the upper window is between the D and the O. If I move to the window below, okay, I can have the pointer in a different position. But the window data structure that corresponds to the window, the upper window, is remembering a different position, a different value for the pointer. You see? Okay, when you switch to a different window, the value of the pointer for that window becomes the value of the pointer for that buffer. Okay? Good. So, why am I talking about two different concepts, the pointer and the cursor? Because the cursor is not the same. The pointer is an integer, is a number, and we will see that you can manipulate a number in your list programs in Emacs. Okay? On the other side, the cursor is just a visual representation of the pointer. Why? Because we are human, and for us it's really useful to have a visual representation of the pointer. Okay? But strictly speaking, we should be able to use Emacs without any visual representation of the cursor. Just getting the value of the pointer in this way, and, well, counting. But it will be really disgusting. So that is the reason we have a cursor. Of course, before you ask, of course you can remove the cursor in Emacs. Or make it invisible. Okay? Why it is important to see the difference between the cursor and the pointer? Because the pointer is a special kind of marker, of mark. That is one of that kind of positions. And what is special about the cursor, one of the special things about the pointer, sorry, is that this has an associated cursor. But now we will see that we can work, and usually in Emacs you work with other markers into the buffers that doesn't have an associated cursor. Mm-hmm. That is the next topic. Regions. In the pseudo editors, usually you have a bunch of operations that are called copy, paste, and cut, right? And usually with some pointing device like a mouse, you select a range of characters from a buffer or a window, depending on the editor, so you can select a range. And usually speaking, you have a visual representation of that range. Okay. In Emacs, it is a bit different. It is a bit different. Because in addition to the pointer, you can define a mark in a buffer. A mark is like a pointer, that is a number that is identifying a position between two given characters in the buffer, but the mark doesn't have a visual representation. It doesn't have a cursor. The command to set the current value of the mark for a given buffer is control space. You know what? I knew my memory, and I think that most of the people have the same problem. My memory of the Emacs keystroke is a physical memory. A lot of time I have to execute the command before to be able to tell to in words the control space. So let's set the mark for this buffer. Move the cursor to some position. And then press control space. Okay, you get a message in the mini buffer, in the mini buffer that is mark set. So Emacs is telling you that he set the value of the for the mark of this corresponding to this buffer. But to which value? To which value? To the current value of the pointer. Okay, so it's like an assignation of a variable. In fact, you can think about the mark of a buffer and the pointer of a window and the pointer of a buffer like variables. Okay? Good. Now the value of the mark is equal to the value of the pointer, because we just execute the set mark value command. But what happens if we move? Well, by the way, the value of the pointer is 36. I think it was a mark, right? It's 36. So it's actually the same. But now let's move. Let's change the value of the pointer. So we move the cursor to a different position. For example, here. Now, the value of the mark is still 36, but the value of the pointer is 44. So it's no longer the same. Okay, good. Okay. Now, in an implicit way, we are defining a region in this buffer. Initially, when you create a buffer, the value of the mark is not set. But after the first time that you set the value of the mark with control space, the mark of the buffer always has a value. Okay? So you are always defining a region that goes between the mark and the pointer, or the pointer and the mark, depending on what is the less value, the lesser value. Do you know what I mean? You will see. There is a very interesting command that is control X, control X. Look what happened in the screen. Control X, control X. Oh, I hate the deviant people. Much better. Are you using Debian or?
TTM is on by default.
What?
TTM is on by default.
In CBS Emacs? Oh, I hate the Emacs people. I hate the Emacs developers. Okay, so what does the command control X, control X? Basically, it interchanges the value of the mark with the value of the pointer. So the new value of the mark is the value of the pointer, and the new value of the pointer is the value of the mark. And you will see that the cursor is jumping. Why? Because the cursor is always following the pointer. Okay? So for example, let's go to the beginning of some word. For example, this T. Now the pointer is pointing to the space between the blank character and the T, and the first letter of the word, right? That correspond to some numeric value. In this case, 59. We can set the mark now to this value, that with control space. Mark set. Now the value of the mark is also 59. Okay. Now we move the cursor, that is, we change the value of the pointer to point here. That is, to the position between the S, that is the last letter of this word, and the blank space. But what is the value of the mark? The mark is still pointing to the position between the blank and the T. Okay, so what will happen now if we exchange the values of the mark and the pointer? Tell me. Okay, again. Where is the cursor? The cursor is on top of the first T of the word. Okay. Where is the pointer pointing currently? Huh? Where? No. The pointer is telling you always a position between two characters in the buffer. After the blank space, the position that is after the blank and before the T. Okay? Perfect. That corresponds to some numerical value. In this case, 59. Okay, but you can forget about the numerical value, but because you know where the pointer is. Okay, now we set the mark with control space. What does that mean? That the value of the mark will become 59, and the mark will be also pointing where? Between the blank space, the blank character, and the first T and the T. We do it. Okay. Now we move the pointer by moving the cursor to a different position. Okay, now where is the pointer pointing? In the position after the S and before the blank. But where is the mark pointing? Between between the blank and before the T. Because if, when we move the cursor, we are changing the value, the actual value of the pointer, but not the value of the mark. Okay. So now, what is the defined region? If we define the region as the space between the mark and the pointer, the region is covering from the position after the blank and before the T to the position after the S and before the blank. So basically, we are covering the word trigos. This is our active region in the Emacs terminology. But as you can see, like we have a visual representation of the pointer that is the cursor, but we don't have a visual representation of the mark. So of course, it will be really difficult to always remember where the mark is. Before, because after the first time that you set the mark has always some value. Okay? For that, we use the control X command that interchange the value of the pointer and the mark. And says after, if you change the value of the pointer, the cursor moves, jumps, so you can see what is the region that you have defined. If you run that command twice, okay, you will back to the initial situation. So for example, suppose that now we don't remember where the mark is. We exchange the value of the mark and the pointer, look at the screen. Pop. Now what is the position pointed by the pointer? After the blank and before the T. And where is the mark now? Yeah. Between the S and the blank. If we execute the command again, look at the screen. Now where is the mark pointing? After the blank and before the T. And where is the pointer? After the S and before the blank. You may think that this is a really complicated way to implement a really simple concept, but in my opinion it's just the opposite. It's a really simple way to implement a really complex concept. Questions? This is very important. In fact, this is more important than to be able to write a Lisp function to do something fancy in Emacs.
Isn't there any function to highlight?
Yes, there is.
Yeah, I have the activate by
default. Ah. Yeah, this is a visual aid for... but people have been surviving without that kind of functions for more than 25 years, so... Also, I find that kind of visual aids disturbing. You know why? Of course, think about this. Think about this. The Emacs is peculiar in one sense. Because in a more conventional text editor, you can get the mouse and you define a region with the mouse. Okay? But after you do anything with that, then you don't have a region defined anymore. Right? But in Emacs, after you set the first value of the mark, there is always some region activated in the buffer, defined by the value of the mark and the pointer. So that was the reason there is not an explicit visual representation of the region by default, because it will be really, really nasty. Because imagine that you forget, you left the mark in the end of the buffer. 200 lines below the current position. you will have a huge part of the buffer in yellow, for example. So it will be really annoying. That is the reason the visual representation of the region in Emacs is called transient mark mode. And it is called transient because it is temporary. It is not always marking the region. And this is one of the reasons I don't like it. But anyway, so now, make a little practice. Go to some word in your buffer and set the point, the mark in the beginning of the word and the pointer in the end of the word, and exchange the values with Ctrl-X, Ctrl-X. Ah, if you want to disable the highlighting, and congratulations, execute this. Well, you can... and then you put the point... Now we can use the proper terminology, because now we are speaking the same language. You can evaluate this list form by putting the pointer at the after the close parentheses and executing Ctrl X, Ctrl E. So you put the pointer here and you execute Ctrl X, Ctrl E. By the way, if you like this kind of of customization, you can write this toolbar mode minus one, menu bar mode minus one, and transient mark mode minus one in your .emacs file. So the next time you execute Emacs, you will have the same settings. And that means that you will be using Lisp, programming in Lisp, and also customizing your Emacs. So after evaluating three really simple list forms, now you know that you are in a higher position in the evolutive chain compared, for example, with a Java programmer with 20 years of experience programming Java. You know.
Some interference.
Yeah. Okay. Another. So, now, let's go for the first practical application of defining a region. Imagine that we want to delete the word trigos from this buffer. The Emacs way to do that is, okay, it's a logical process. First, you should have some way to mark that word, to tell Emacs what do you want to delete from the buffer, okay? And then you should launch some kind of command to actually delete the content that you want to delete. The first step, you do it in Emacs by defining a region covering the portion of the buffer that you want to delete or to kill. In this case, the triggers word. Okay, now we know how to define a region, right? What would you do? That was a question. How do you define a region to cover the word trigos? Again. okay, you set the mark between the blank space, the blank and the T, with control space. Okay? And then we move the pointer where? Between the S and the blank. And then we have this region defined. Control X, control X, control X, control X. And now, with a new command that is control double view, okay, we can, using a more conventional terminology, we can cut the region. Control double view. Boom. Okay? Of course, if I just change again the value of the mark and the pointer in this way, what will happen if I press control double view? No idea. Okay, that we should roll back to the concepts again then. Okay, what is the region now? The active region. Yeah. So now I can delete the region with control double view. Okay? So the word gets deleted from the buffer. Okay, but if I just change the value of the pointer and the mark, what is the active region now? The same. Because okay. This was with control double view. Control double view is killing the text in the Emacs terminology. In the Emacs terminology, to kill a region, to kill some text, is to delete it from the buffer, and also to save it in a data structure that is called the kill ring. Okay, that is some kind of sophisticated clipboard. With control Y, with control double view, is the command to kill the text, the active region. With control junk, we are junking the text again in the buffer. To junk a text in the Emacs terminology, that is not the same that the VI terminology, that in case, because in VI to junk a text is something completely different. To junk a text is to get the text from the clipboard, from that sophisticated clipboard that is the kill ring, that we will see in detail later, and to insert it again in the current position determined by the pointer. So in other words, to kill the text is the equivalent of cut in a more conventional pseudo editor, and to junk the text is the equivalent to the paste operation in a more conventional pseudo editor. Okay? So now practice it for a bit. Now you can you have enough knowledge to be able to kill some words or some or any parts of your buffer, and to paste it or to junk it in different places. Play with it until you get comfortable with the. Remember, this is a control double view for to kill, and control Y. I don't know, what is the English word for the Y? Huh?
What's the purpose?
What is the English word for this
why?
Letter?
Why?
Ah, why? Ah, interesting. Control Y. Okay, there is also a different operation that is also operating in the active region, that is meta double view. Do you know what the meta key is? You can use the Alt key in a PC keyboard, or the Escape key. But note that if you use Escape, you should not maintain the Escape pressed and then the double view. When you should, but is escape and then you release the escape key and then the double view. Well, this command meta.dovilview is to copy text into the sophisticated clipboard, into the kill ring, but without deleting it from the buffer. So it is the meta.dovilview is the equivalent of the copy operation from the more conventional pseudo editors. So for example, for the word triggers, we can define again the region, setting the mark, moving the pointer to the end of the word, and then with meta.dovilview we get it into the kill ring. So we can go to a different place of the buffer and junk it. Actually, triggers is not the right example for this exercise, but much better. Okay. Well, it was a joke, but. So with control double view, control Y, and the meta double view, we are covering the equivalent in Emacs terms of copy, paste, and cut. And also we have the concept of the region. Okay, so now you are in a position where you can manipulate the text in your buffers. Note that of course we didn't use the mouse at all, and that is in purpose. Because to use a mouse is a waste of time, most of the time. Now, there are some utility functions in Emacs that just for your convenience, but that, for example, there is a really handy function that has an associated keystroke that is Ctrl X H. Okay. This is quite useful. I will tell you, I will describe it to you, and then you will explain me in understandable terms what it does. Control XH set the value of the pointer to 1 and the value of the mark to the number of characters in the current buffer. What do it do? Exactly. It's really useful, of course, because sometimes you want to copy all the contents of a given buffer into another one. Do that. This was my buffer. So say that we want to create a new buffer, my buffer 3, for example, and we want to copy all the contents of my buffer into my buffer 3. Do it. You can create a new window. You can switch to the new buffer, my buffer 3, then you back to the main buffer. You execute Ctrl XH to select all the contents of this buffer. Then you can copy the contents with meta double view. You can switch again to the main buffer 3 and then junk it. I will kill you all. Got it? Okay, this command control XH is also very comfortable because I usually use it to go to the end of the file and to back to the beginning of the file. There are some situations where you open a file and you are interested in seeing, for example, a log. Usually, what are the important, the interesting the parts of a log? Usually, the beginning and the end. So this command is really helpful for that, because you can make a control XH and then use control X to go from the beginning to the end. The beginning, the end, and again. It's really useful. What?
Just need a greater than, smaller than.
Ah, yeah, but I prefer this way. Okay, now get your hands out of the keyboard. Now you will make an exercise. Now you will create a .emacs file in your home directory. You know how to do that using Emacs already. And you remember that we have this transient mark mode -1 in the my buffer or similar. In your, you should have it somewhere in your Emacs in some buffer, and also other little lisp expressions, right? So now you will create, using only the keystrokes, no mouse, no additional facilities that you already know. The exercise is to create the .emacs file containing just the lisp forms. So the next time that you start Emacs, you will have it properly configured. Okay, go for it. You will need to copy or to cut, to kill, maybe, to use fin file, to use a junk, to use control XO to move to different windows and that kind of stuff. The idea is to do this by copying the list form that you should have already in some buffers.
Okay, is there any way to
auto-complete
functions in the buffer?
Yeah, of course there is.
Okay.
No, you don't want to know it now. Yeah, yeah. You know that the knowledge is dangerous. Yeah, for the security of the nation. that only means that the people from ISO they don't have a single clue about mathematics. Yeah. To not load the .emacs file.
Okay, so we now should start without the
minus. Yeah, of course. But in my case it was needed because this is a vanilla Emacs with authentic customization. And I have a pretty big .emacs file. A command that
opens directly the document.
No.
Instead of
there is not a built-in command, but you can create one very easily. Like well, more than you can find. It's a good indentation if you are not in a. For this kind of work, it's better to use the scratch buffer. Much better. Well, or much better. It should be some Emacs init file. No. Yeah, user. Init file. Oh, good. Ah, of course.
You don't actually have to test that it's null.
Yeah, you have.
No.
Yes.
It's always set.
No.
Are you sure?
Oh, look at this. Look at the mini buffer.
Yeah. even know by default.
But there should be some kind of default user init file. What is the default for that? Should be somewhere. So, do you have the .emacs file, and you created it copying and pasting and killing and junking the text, right? Okay, so now that you have a .emacs file, you can restart your Emacs and start it without specifying -q. You did that, okay. So, there are a lot of useful commands that you can find in your reference card that you have it. For example, the meta bigger than, greater than, that moves the pointer to the end of the file without modifying the mark. This was this command. You have also meta less than, that it sets the value to the pointer to 1, that is it moves the pointer to the cursor to the beginning of the line of the file without touching the mark, and so on. Okay, so if you remember the switch to buffer function, that you invoke it using the control X B, you can get access to the to have a window to the completions window with the different buffers. Look, after this stupid use of the editor, now we have more than 11 buffers in the editor. So this means that soon the number of buffers in any real working session gets really high. A lot of them. For that, there is a different command, that is Control X, Control B. It's this one, Control X, Control B. That moves to you to some kind of interactive buffer containing a list of the different existing buffers. Control X, Control B. You have a buffer list. Okay. This is a new kind of Emacs buffer. It's a normal Emacs buffer in the end, and the name of the buffer is star buffer list star, so it's an automatically created buffer. Okay. But as the mode that you can see in the mode line, it has buffer menu, and this is the number of the major mode active in this buffer. This is an interactive buffer. In Emacs, the buffers can get interactive because they can have links, for example. So here, if you press N, you can move. You will see that instead of printing an end in the buffer, it is moving the cursor to the next line, so you can go down line by line. If you press P for previews, instead of printing a P, you can travel with the cursor back. What does this mean? Well, And now you may ask to yourself, okay, so this means that this is some kind of a special buffer. No. This is a regular Emacs buffer. That is showing you that a regular Emacs buffer can be interactive, like this one. It's some kind of application user interface in the end. What is the utility of this buffer, of this interactive buffer? Basically, that you can go to some line and press enter, and then you go to the selected buffer. Okay, it's not the more fancy user interface ever, but as an example of a buffer implementing some interactive feature, it's not a bad example. Also, incidentally, this buffer is giving us some interesting information. For example, the modification state of the buffer, if the buffer is read only or it is read write permissions, the number of the buffer, the size, the current size in octets of the buffer, the major mode that the buffer is in the current time, and the file, the associated file, but only if the buffer is associated with the file, of course. So, for example, we say that Scratch, by default, when you start Emacs, is not associated with a file. So that is the reason the last column for help for Scratch is empty. The same for help, that is another automatically created buffer. Apropos is yet another automatically created buffer that is not associated with a file. And it is here because I run the apropos command. But, for example, we have my buffer that is associated with a file, my buffer 3, and also my buffer 3, sorry. No, my buffer 3, no. Or yes. I cannot say it. No. My file 2, I'm sorry. Okay. So now create a new buffer in your Emacs. For example, in my case, it will be my buffer 4. In your case, I suppose that you have a fresh process. So okay, look at the strange characters that are in the left side of the mode line before the name of the buffer. Okay, we have the name of the buffer, this is my buffer 4, and we have two dashes, this one and this one, there are two of them, and then a colon and three additional dashes. Okay? Good. Now I launched a command that is toggle read only. Okay? That makes a buffer, mark a buffer as a read only buffer. So if I try to insert some content into the buffer, I get an error and a notification in the MIDI buffer that this buffer is read only. You cannot write contents into the buffer. Okay? How do you know if a given buffer is read only? With this character, that is a percentage. But you have two of them. The first one, after the colon, it says to you if the buffer is read-only or not. If it is not read-only, it is a dash, like by default. So this means that this buffer is readable. Okay? If there is a percentage sign there, that means that the buffer is not readable, it's read-only. Okay. What happens if we modify the contents of the buffer? Look, I will insert a character in the buffer. Look at the characters in the mode line. We have, in the second dash, now became a star, an asterisk. And that means that the buffer has been modified. Okay. Good. If we associate the buffer with a file, to do that, by the way, you can set a buffer with a file with Ctrl X, Ctrl W. This way, the file, my file 4. We can make a modification in the buffer, and then we see the asterisk there in the mode line, meaning that the buffer has been modified. If we save the contents of the buffer into the associated file with Ctrl X, Ctrl S, then the stars become again a dashes, meaning that there is that the content of the current contents of the buffer are in line with the contents of the file. Okay? Good. But did you note that we have two dashes in the mode and that they're changing with asterisks? Okay, it's not this one. Look, we have the colon, and then we have this one that is telling us that the buffer is readable, in this case, and this one that is telling us that the buffer has not been modified. If we modify the buffer again, now we have two asterisks, two stars. The first one is telling us that the buffer is readable, and the second, like before, and the second one is telling us that the buffer is modified. But what is the difference between the both marks? There is a subtle difference, because if we have a buffer that is associated with a file, okay, the buffer may be read only and not modified. But the buffer may be read-only, but already modified and not in line with the contents of the file. So, for example, this buffer has the context "hello." Okay, I save it. So now the contents of the buffer are in line with the contents of the associated file, right? Good. Now I tell Emacs, well, that this buffer is read-only. So we get in the mode line the percentage sign, two of them. So I cannot modify the contents of the buffer. But look, we may have, if now I introduce this word here, now the contents of the file is hello. But the contents of the buffer now are not in line with the contents of the in line with the update regarding the contents of the file. Okay, so we have the asterisk below. And what will happen if now I tell Emacs that this buffer is read only? Now we have a percentage sign and an asterisk, and this means something that is really funny. This means that the contents of the buffer are not in line with the contents of the file, and also the buffer is read-only. That is the reason we have two different characters in the mode lines. In the mode line, they may be a bit confused, but it is not. Of course, did you know that one thing is that a file in the file system is read-only, but for example, but you can have a different protection in the buffer. So, for example, kill anyway. If I open a read-only file, for example, etc password, okay? What is the mode line telling to us? That this buffer is read-only and has not been modified. Both things. But I can tell Emacs to toggle the that property of this buffer, even if the associated file is read-only. So I can tell Emacs, toggle read-only. and then look at the mode line. This buffer is no longer read-only. I can modify it. Of course, I am just modifying a buffer in memory with the current contents of the etc password file, but if I try to save it into the file, it will fail, of course. You see? So basically, the characters after the colon, the first one, it tells you if the buffer is readable or not. Mm-hmm. If it is a percentage sign, that means that the buffer is a read-only buffer. If it is either a dash or an asterisk, it means that the buffer is readable. The second one tells you if the contents of the buffer has been modified or not regarding this read file. And you can have any combination of both characters. Okay? Also, you can visit a read-only file and make modifications in the buffer related with that file. Of course, the problem then is that you won't be able to save the contents of the buffer into the file. But you can. And also you can make exactly the opposite. You can open a file for which you have permissions to write, for example, our TMP file, my file 2, but imagine that you have some important information in this file and you want to read the contents of the file, but you don't want to change the contents in a mistake, so you can declare the buffer as a read-only one, so you can have any combination in the end. Because a memory buffer is not the same than the file associated with the buffer. So I think that we already covered most of the basic edition concepts. The rest of the edition concept, you can build them using the concept of pointer, the concept of mark, the concept of region, and all the rest. So I think that it's enough for today. Tomorrow we will learn Lisp, and I think that I hope that Luca will help me in that.
Okay, we're going to do us together, sure.
Yeah.
And anyway, despite the opinion of Jose, I don't dislike this. It contains essentially all the commands you mentioned.